blood that still has saving and keeping power. Blood that encompasses, surrounds, and is certainly a fence all around us each and every day. Thank God for this privilege of worship. Thank God for this Sunday.
That's why TV ratings are so high, and that's why reality
TV shows have become so popular, because if I cannot live the good life, I want to live vicariously through somebody else. We want to experience the good life. As a matter of fact, there is a whole nother segment of Christianity, which is really not Christianity, but it really is what is called the prosperity gospel.
Come on, man.
And the prosperity gospel is literally this. They have baptized the materialism of the world and put Christian labels on it and repackaged it as the gospel for the church. Somebody talk to me here today. And what we need to understand is that when we pursue that, we are really pursuing materialism disguised as Christianity. I want you to understand something today. We've got to ask our Lord and Savior, literally, what is the good life? Jesus tells a wonderful parable and story that helps us to understand what it means to live life in its fullest measure. He gives us a definition of the abundant life, or living life in all of its fullness. The Lord literally says, there's one avenue you can go. And when you go this avenue in pursuit of the good life, it will lead to destruction. But when you go the other avenue, it will lead to construction. Listen, the only way to eternal life is through faith in Christ. But you and I don't simply stop there. Listen, we need to make sure that our souls are bound for heaven. And the only way to do that is by putting your faith in the blood, the choir says, still works. And I think I ought to pause right now and let you know that even though it's the first Sunday and we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper, if you have not experienced this blood, you cannot move on to the abundant life without eternal life. A prerequisite for the abundant life is this eternal life. By faith in Christ, we have eternal life, but we don't stop there. There is more living that goes on here on earth. And many of us are living beneath the privilege that the Lord has for us. For life to be abundant, it must have abundant resources. And the only unlimited source of life is Christ. Jesus says in this same gospel, John 14 and verse 6, I am the way. I am the truth. And finally, I am the life. Listen, the only way you can live the good life, the only thing that can make you happy, is for you to have unlimited resources. We spend. We work astronomical hours each and every week trying to pursue unlimited resources. But your resources will never be unlimited. As a matter of fact, the Bible says it's better for you to lay up treasures in heaven where moth and rust cannot destroy. The good news is Jesus is the only source of unlimited resources. For life to be abundant, it must have abundant resources. And Jesus is that only unlimited supply. In order for us to possess this fuller life, we must abide in Him. Now listen, abundant living is God's norm for all believers. Sadly, most believers never experience this in-depth life that the Lord has for us. We should never be satisfied with less than what God has for us. So the Bible tells us about this door to abundant life. You got to understand, the abundant life is a yielded life. One thing for you and I to live in Christ, it's another thing for Christ to live in and through us. Abundant life or defeated life is your choice. Abundant life, the Bible says, is a service life. You've got to yield yourself as living sacrifices unto the Lord. Abundant life is a separated life. You cannot live in the world and live for Christ at the same time and expect to experience this abundant life. This abundant life is a spirit-filled life that is controlled by the Holy Spirit. Amen. Matter of fact, today, my brothers and sisters, within the Christian liturgical calendar is Pentecost Sunday. call Sunday is when the church celebrates not only the birth of the church, but the giving of the Holy Spirit. In the Old Testament economy, the Israelites would come to Jerusalem for a number of annual feasts. One annual feast was the Feast of the Passover, and the Feast of the Passover was that time during the year whenever the lamb was sacrificed for the sins of the people. Jesus was sacrificed on the cross during the time of the Passover, and because Christ was sacrificed once and for all, there no longer needs to be an annual or perpetual sacrifice, because the blood still works. Listen, that Passover for us inaugurates what is called the Lent or the Easter season. And so when Jesus transformed the Passover lamb to his own flesh and blood, the Passover became our Resurrection Sunday celebration. But in keeping with the liturgical calendar, the Bible says after the Passover, when Jesus was crucified and got up from the grave, the Bible says that Jesus, in his resurrected body, appeared for 40 days on earth, showing himself with many infallible proofs that he was the one that rose from the grave. Showed himself to Paul, appeared to James, and appeared to the disciples in the upper room, appeared to the disciples on the Emmaus Road. At the end of 40 days, the Bible says out in Acts chapter 1, on the 40th day, Jesus ascended into heaven. The disciples, 120, assembled in the upper room for a prayer meeting in response to what Jesus said. Tarry in Jerusalem until you be endued with power. Jesus showed himself 40 days. They prayed in the upper room for 10 days. That comes to 50 days. So Passover was followed by another feast called the Feast of Weeks or the Feast of Pentecost. 50 days after the Passover lamb was slain. Somebody talk to me in this place. So they prayed for 10 more days. And on the 50th day, the Holy Spirit fell on the disciples, gave them the power to live the abundant life that only God can live. And that's why we celebrate this wonderful day of Pentecost. And Jesus said this Spirit would allow us to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. So you got to understand that that abundant life is a mature life. Many of us don't experience the best that life can offer. So life winds up being lifeless, miserable. Our existence literally squashes human potential. But in order to have a rich, full, joyful life, one that overflows with meaningful activities under the personal hand and blessing of God, we've got to be children of God. Amen. The Lord begins John chapter 10 by giving a parable of sheep that have a shepherd. And Jesus in this parable helps us to understand that he is both the shepherd and the sheep. Amen. And you've got to understand, in first century Israel, a sheep did not exist within an enclosed pasture. There were no fences. Their shepherds led them all around the countryside. So at night, they did not have the protection of a fence. So at nighttime, when it was time to sleep, the shepherd literally would lead them into an enclosed cave area. And the shepherd would not put a rock in front of the hole. The shepherd would lay down in front of the cave in order to protect the sheep, so the sheep could not get in and out without going through the door of the shepherd. And enemies could not get in without going through the shepherd. So Jesus said, I am the door. And anybody that comes in without coming through me safety and sustenance for your life. Listen, Jesus said, number one, the door to life is a person. He said, I am the door. The door to life is Jesus. You don't have to kick the door in. You don't have to buy a door to the good life. Jesus says it's simple. Come through me. Allow my life to be lived through you. And the abundant life will automatically become yours. You don't have to buy it. Don't have to chase it. Don't have to put nothing on it. Don't have to go in debt. Come through the door that I open. Many of us, we misunderstand about this abundance. You've got to understand that Daniel lived the abundant life. His life was not comfortable, but his life was abundant. Because the character and the glory of God shone through his life, even in the midst of discomfort. Many of us, we misunderstand abundance. We also, my brothers and sisters, misunderstand the entrance. Because Jesus said, listen, it's not something you do to have the good life. It's a response to an invitation that I give. Come unto me, and the life that goes beyond what is expected is something that I supernaturally give. And Jesus says we also need to understand the depth of the full life is protected. Listen, you see in this verse, Jesus says in the verse, the depth of the full life is this, you'll be protected because you'll go in and out. You'll go in and out. In other words, you can go out, I'll watch over you. You can come back in, I'll watch over you. But not only does it bring safety and security, but it brings sustenance. Because he said you'll go in and out, and when you go out, guess what? You won't buy it, you won't hunt for it, you'll just find pasture. The idea of finding pasture is simply you'll find what you're chasing when you come in and out the right door. Right door, you don't have to pursue things. Things will pursue you. Come here, Jesus, Matthew 6 and 33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, and all these things will come chasing you. You don't have to chase them. You'll go in and out. Ain't got to worry about no enemy. Go in and out. Ain't got to worry about no thieves and robbers. Go in and out. And simply find pasture. And then he says, the desire of this full life is provided when we find pasture. Jesus says that he is the purpose of this wonderful life. Many of us, my brothers and sisters, we miss out on the good life because we fall for the wrong deal. There was a show that was on many years ago that has been reinvented today called Let's Make a Deal. You know, Let's Make a Deal, you find these persons that come forward. And they're given one or two options. You can take that which is visible, or you can opt to choose that which is hidden and invisible. And studies show that most people, in pursuit of the good life, more often than not will choose that which is visible over against that which is invisible. And more often than not, what is behind door number one, two, or three is often greater than what's in the hand of the host. Listen, my brothers and sisters, when the devil was tempting Jesus in the wilderness, he said, Jesus, let's make a deal. Take what I'm showing you and forfeit what is behind the curtain. But listen, Jesus didn't fall for the deal because he knew what was behind the curtain was greater than what in the enemy hands. And many of us, my brothers and sisters, we fall for the thief and the robber that offers us the physical good life. But I want you to know behind the veil, there was one who died on the cross. Behind the veil, that was went into from top to bottom. believe. Because the Bible says, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man the things that God has behind door number one for the Father, behind door number two for the Son, behind door number three for the Spirit, door one for the fruit of the Father. Because we want to steal, kill, and destroy, but behind God wants to give us that abundant life. He wants us to give us that in-depth life that we can experience the fullness and the joy of our salvation. And so Jesus says, listen, I am the door, but I'm also the shepherd. I'll lead you to the door, but I'll also then be the door, your avenue or access in. And once you come in and give me your life, I'll still be the door. I'll let you know when it's safe to go out. I'll let you know when it's time to come back in. And when you go out, I'll make sure that you find pasture, that you don't have to run and look for it. And that's the promise of this door. He is the door of the sheep. But here is the key to all this abundant living. When you go back to verse 3, he says, I am the door. And my sheep know my voice. The critical component to our not experiencing abundant life is either our not knowing his voice or our disobedience to his voice. So you got to make up your mind. You first of all need to study his word so much that you know his voice and somebody else you won't listen to. And then when you hear your voice, you have to yield yourself to his voice and be obedient. Without doing one of those two, you can pursue the abundant life all you want, but it'll never come to you. His voice is speaking right now as the deacons come. His voice speaks through his word. Calls us from darkness into the marvelous light. Calls you to the door of salvation. His blood still works. We invite you to stand all over the building. Give us your hand and give Christ your heart.